So I have been a little bit behind. This is the eighth week, I believe. We're through the departmental midterms, which means it's time to meet with me. So I have a sheet here. If you want to come meet with me tomorrow, or if you're in the mood, you can stop by office hours today. Just, you know, 5-10 minutes. I just want to check in with everybody. So we don't have too many people waiting around outside. I'll pass this around. But again, if you'd rather come during today's office hours and just risk having to wait a few minutes, that's good. And if you don't do it this week, we'll do it next week. So don't feel like you have to do it today or tomorrow. All right, how's everyone doing? Okay, you survived all of our interlacing. Okay. Well, there's the regrades now, and I've noticed that our TAs are very literal, and if our students do anything slightly different, they sometimes don't catch on to it. So it's an interesting process. It's an interesting process. I am not saying anything bad about our graders. I think our graders did a great job. When you go through and grade 1,000 tests, there's interesting variations that you don't anticipate. It's good. You'll discover this for the next 40 years while you grade calculus test after calculus test after calculus test. I strongly encourage you to shoot for a position at a school where you don't have to teach the same class year after year. I know this has nothing to do with spectrograph theory, but this is some life advice. The first class I ever taught was trigonometry. And I taught it 3 semesters in a row. And the first semester, I was scared to death. I was barely keeping up with the students. I survived it. Kind of like what's happening right now with Calc 2. Second semester, I taught it right afterwards. I really hit my stride. I was loving it. Everything was great. Pacing was good. Life was great. Third semester, I was bored out of my mind. I just could not get myself to like trigonometry for the life of me. It's easy to say ahead of time, oh sure, I can teach calculus every single semester for the next 20 years of my life. But when then you're actually faced with it and you discover, you know, it's not as fun as it sounds. And so I would encourage you, try to find a job where at least from time to time, you'll get to teach something different. It'll help. It'll help you keep sane. So, okay, life advice 101. Any other life advice you want me to dish out today? No? Okay, all right. Well, anyways, that's my own heavily biased opinion. Okay. So today, we're going to talk about Cheeger's constant. And in particular, Cheeger's inequality. But to get to that, we want to talk a little bit about a very basic question. How do we measure size? Or how do we measure what's important in a graph? And I'll put size here in quote marks, you know, because that's not clear. What do we mean by size? Okay. So in particular, if I'm looking at a subgraph of a graph, how big is it? Now, what are some reasonable ways to talk about bigness when it comes to subgraphs? Sorry, what? Yes? No? Maybe? Anyone? Number of edges. Wow. Going for the win right away.
Yeah.
Okay. I was hoping someone was going to do the more obvious one.
Number of vertices. I was fixing that in my head.
So number of vertices is almost always what people think of when they talk about size. And so oftentimes, if you look in various books, I think even I've done this in the past, where I talk about the size of the graph, I put G in absolute value signs. So it's not like I'm taking the absolute value of G. Whenever you see absolute value signs, that's really just a way of saying, how big is this? So how big is this graph? And usually this refers to the number of vertices. But there's a different measurement, and that's the number of edges. Now, we don't want to use the same notation for two different things, so we're going to use different notation.
Can we use two absolute value bars?
No. We're not going to do that. Instead, we're going to use, sorry, what? Well, yes, we could do that, but I want to focus on a subgraph, you know, and like, you know, how important is this part of the graph? So let me give you an analogy here. Suppose I have a graph which models the internet. Now, this is a graph which is very interesting, and some companies study it and make a few billion dollars off of it. And so we have this big collection of things. We have various nodes, and nodes we can represent as websites, and we have links between them. Now, technically speaking, the internet, it's a directed graph, because what the connections are links. For the sake of making it easy for me to draw the picture, let me just pretend like I have undirected. So if you link to something, they also link to you. Now, it's hard to draw the internet graph, because the internet graph tends to be very big. But let's talk about two random websites. I've looked around the internet, and I found that there were some various websites which were very popular. Here's two of them. Google.com and Funny Cat Pics, where pics is spelled P-I-X, so you know it's very funny. And these websites are both websites. They actually do exist. You can go visit them. I will say one of them is a major driver of internet traffic, and the other one is a search engine. If you look at these, if you think about what's happening here in the graph, you'll see that Google will have lots and lots and lots of connections. You know, it's highly linked to. So this is an important vertex, and Funny Cat Pics, unfortunately, it only has a few links.
How does it go directly there?
It's probably true.
It's
probably true. It's, you know, it's in your links from grandma. You know, look at what this funny cat I saw on Funny Cat Pics today. You know, forward, forward, forward kind of emails that you get from relatives. That's usually where you find these types of websites. So obviously my point here is, as websites, it's clear that Google is more important. But if we only say, well, look, the value of a website is how many websites there are. It's one website. This is one website for Google. It's one website for Funny Cat Pics. So what should be important is not how many sites are involved, but rather how many links are involved. How connected are you? And that's coming to what's called number of edges. And so there's a philosophy, and we get to what's called the volume. And so the volume of any subset of vertices, so the volume of S, which is a subset of the vertices of G. Now, this is different from the number of vertices. So the number of vertices would just be how large S is, if we're talking subset. We're talking about the edges in the whole graph. That's just the edges of the graph. Well, what's the, how much is there in a subset? And the answer is that, well, note this volume, V-O-L, of S is equal to the sum over all vertices in S of the degree of S. And that's the volume. So it's the sum of your degrees. So in other words, you're measuring how many links do you have. Now, you might complain, and it's fairly justifiable to do so, that doesn't this possibly double count? Because if I have a subset here, and I have two vertices which are connected, well, when I'm adding up the connections, I add one vertex, and I say, aha, look, there's this edge here. But I go to this other vertex in the same subset and say, oh, look, there's the edge again. Let me count it again. So that the volume is double counting things inside of there. And the answer is yes, we do that on purpose, deliberately. You may say, well, why? Wouldn't it make sense to only count that once? And the answer is, Well, if we count it twice, we get better formulas. And so we'll count it twice. You know, it's basically a philosophy of mathematics is you first figure out what you can prove, and then you choose your definitions to suit that. And so that's what's going on here is we figure out what can we prove, and we chose our definitions to suit that. Now, it should be noted here, before I go much further in talking about what Jeager's constant is, that for regular graphs, is there much difference between thinking about number of vertices or number of edges? No, why not? Yes, that's right. So for regular graphs, these two notions of saying, well, how many vertices do you have versus how many connections slash edges do you have, it doesn't matter. Which is sort of the frustrating thing is, you know, people develop all these cool ideas about regular graphs, and they say, okay, oh, well, it must be all about the vertices. But they don't understand that secretly in the background, it was all about the edges the whole time. They just missed it somehow because they sort of had this easy substitute, which was equivalent. And so it helps to have that understanding about, you know, what's really going on, especially when you start moving away from regular graphs. Because not all graphs are regular. So the internet, that's not a regular graph. And so you want to make sure you have the right idea of saying, well, how do things change when you go to different graphs? All right. Now, you might say, what does all this have to do with Jeager's constant? And the answer is we haven't even talked about Jeager's constant. What I want to do is I just want to define volume. And on a side note, about the only place you'll see volume is when you talk about the normalized Laplacian. So I've never seen people use volume for other matrices. But then again, for almost all other matrices, people try to stick to regular graphs, and they're scared to go to non-regular graphs. So normalized Laplacian, no fear. No fear. We can take those non-regular graphs, and we're cool with it. We can do it. Okay. So now we can talk about another notion, getting us closer to Jeager's. So what we want to measure is we're trying to get more into a qualitative type questions, trying to say, well, what can we say about our graphs? And one of the things we can ask is, you know, how easy is it to cut our graph? And I suppose I should give some examples. Well, what's a cut? Pictorially, you might have something where we have, say, a four cycle and a three cycle, and then there's a path between them. And I want to say, well, I want to cut the graph into two parts, two components. So in other words, I want to take something which is originally connected, and I want to end up with something which is disconnected. So that's a cut. Now, there's two types of cuts. There's a vertex cut, and there's an edge cut. Now, what are these? In both cases, removing these either vertices or edges results in a disconnected graph. Now, in some sense, I think edge cuts are a little bit more interesting. One of the reasons being that you run into the problem of what does it take to cut a complete graph? You know, if you have a vertex cut of a complete graph, is it ever disconnected? I don't know. Who took graph theory last semester? What's the answer? What's the vertex cut number of a complete graph? It's n minus 1, yeah. So for them, it's disconnected when it's down to a single vertex. Of course, you know, is it really disconnected? If there's only one vertex, I mean, come on. All right. But for edge cuts, it makes sense. Now, I should point out here, for something like this, where there's something connected by a path, well, it's pretty easy to find a cut. You can either delete a vertex, or you can delete an edge. So pretty simple. So with either one vertex or one edge, I can disconnect my graph. Now, that says I can do it, but you'll notice I had this word here, how easy is it to do? And so I don't just want to cut, I want an efficient cut. So somehow we have to decide, what does it mean to be efficient? Well, so an efficient cut should have two important properties. And you probably can guess what they are. So I will let you guess what they are. Or you'll make a guess and I'll say, yes, let me paraphrase it. Sorry, what? Well, yes. So an efficient cut should be a cut. I agree. I'll add that as a third property, is a cut.
Number of pages should be minimum.
Well, we have to be careful there. It should be small. Now, I don't want it to be minimum. You're probably thinking, wait a second, don't you want that to be efficient? Well, hold on, because there's another property. So I want it to be a cut, small cut. I don't want it necessarily to be the smallest number of edges I have to delete, because I'm looking to cut it in a nice way. Sorry, what?
I want it to be easy to find.
Well, you know, you're talking like an applied mathematician. We're pure mathematics. We don't care about how easy it is to find things. We're willing to suffer. Well, that's like saying you have a cut and yeah. That's more along the lines of each cut. But you were mentioning you want the sizes.
The size of the components should be somewhat kind of not much less, I mean, not much larger or not much smaller. The sizes should be somewhat kind of symmetrical.
Well, at least as to a degree, yeah. You want the pieces left to be large. In other words, you know, it's not very hard to find efficient, really tiny cuts. So let me give you an example. I can take a graph and perhaps, I don't know. Should I draw? All right. You have to pretend like I can draw in four dimensions. So in case you can't visualize in three dimensions, what I am attempting to draw and doing a very poor job of it is a four-dimensional hypercube. Okay. So there's a three-cube inside of a three-cube. I think it's not an unreasonable attempt. But anyways, I would point out to you that it's not very hard to cut this graph. And I should say, for the rest of today's topic, we're going to focus on edge cuts. It's not very hard to cut this graph to make two components. What's a very easy way to make two components on this graph?
Isolate a vertex.
Yes, to isolate a vertex. You can always isolate any vertex. You just take its vertex and you delete all the edges coming off of it. Okay, so it's very easy to make a cut where I isolate a single vertex. But what's bad about this? Well, what's bad is that you have a very small part and a ridiculously huge part. So in some sense, it's not a great cut. Because yes, it's true, you did cut it in half, but you cut it in half in a silly way, leaving one huge piece and one small piece. What's perhaps a quote-unquote better cut? Yeah. So how do I make that cut?
Cut all of those edges that are connecting the outer cube to the inner.
Yeah, so I can essentially go through and like slice it. Okay, this is but I can, okay, maybe if I had drawn my cube in a better way. So you can draw your cube so that you have sort of a two little tiny cubes stacked underneath one another. Okay, this is getting really bad. All right.
Squares have four edges.
That's a square.
Yeah. Okay. So, anyways, there's a cube and there's another cube and then there's these edges in between the cubes. And it's like that's what we're cutting, is those edges between the two cubes.
Okay.
All right. Now, what's great about this cut? Well, first off, it's not the smallest possible cut. Let's be clear about that. So here, to isolate a vertex, I only need to cut four edges. But to separate these two cubes, I have to cut eight edges. So it's in the sense of how many edges I'm cutting a lot more. But in terms of ending up with two large pieces, this is a much better thing. So we have to somehow balance this. We want to have both things taken into account. I want a very small, in terms of number of edges, very small cut, and somehow end up with a fairly large, substantial thing. So what we need to do is have some way to measure this. And so we start by looking at what's called the Cheeger. I think it's called the Cheeger ratio or Cheeger constant, but anyways, here we go. I've seen it denoted H, and I have no idea why. So H sub G of S. So S here is just some subset of the vertices, and I'm asking, how good is my cut to separate S from everything else? So this is for S, a subset of the vertices. Well, I need to do two things. I need to balance off. First off, I have to look at how many edges I have to cut to separate S. And the answer to that is I simply say, let's look at the edges between S and S bar. And so we'll denote that E of S comma S bar. And then I'll take the size of that set. So this is number of edges between S and S bar. Okay, so how many edges coming out of S into somewhere else? Every edge that's coming out from S to something out of S, I have to cut it because I'm trying to isolate S itself. Now, hopefully you'll see that I wrote that a little bit high because there's a second part and that goes underneath. So I want the number of edges to be small, and at the same time, I want to make sure that I end up with big pieces. And so the way I denote this is I take downstairs the minimum of the volume of S and the volume of the complement of S. So by taking the minimum, it says, well, look, you're penalized if you cut off something which is very small. Because if you cut off something very small, you get a very small, you'll take the small part. So what you really want to try to do is make sure both the volume of S and the volume of the complement of S, that both of those are large. Because then if both of those are large, that makes the whole quantity small. All right, so now that's for one set S. Finally, we can define the Cheeger constant, H sub G, is equal to the min over all S of H sub G of S. Okay, so that is our Cheeger constant. One note, what can we say? Well, a little note to the side here. If G is disconnected, what's true about our Cheeger constant?
Zero.
Yeah. Why is it zero? Yeah. If it's disconnected, I just split my graph S. S is one connected component. S complements everything else. And it takes me no edges to isolate. And so it's zero over something. If it's connected, then it's positive. Now, this is the nice thing about working with this parameter, is that at least it's some number. And what we want to do is we want to say that it's small. That's our goal. Well, actually, I suppose that you have one or two goals depending upon what you're interested in. If it's small, that means somewhere there's a nice efficient cut. If it's high, that means that there's not an efficient cut. Now, what do you want? Well, it depends on your application. Well, what do you mean? Suppose you were a telephone network. Now, I'll comment that if you go and read through any of the older papers on things like spectral graph theory or graphs in general, there's a tendency for people to talk about applications using phone networks. There's a reason for that. This was back in the days when they had a monopoly. There was a company called AT&T. They basically owned all the phones They charge ridiculous amounts of money. But as a consequence, the government required them to pour a large amount of money into research. Of course, they didn't care. It was spare change for them. But they had Bell Labs. So Bell Labs did a lot of research. And in fact, a lot of the really great advances in technology and mathematics and science came out of Bell Labs. Of course, eventually they broke up the monopoly. Then they didn't have money going into Bell Labs. And now we're in the dark ages of that we live in today. But that's OK. Now we have Google, so. Yes, our funny cat pics, you know, one of those two. We have both of them now. But my point here is that a lot of the applications, oftentimes Bell Labs, you know, they funded research, but they said, well, you know, occasionally you got to throw us a bone and make something useful for telephone networks. And so a lot of times they had to, well, let's think about telephone networks. Now, suppose you were a telephone network. Would you want to have your Cheeger constant be small or your Cheeger constant be large?
Large.
Large. Why would you want your Cheeger constant to be large?
It should be resilient against hurricanes, for example.
Yeah. It should be resilient against hurricanes or drunk people driving into your telephone poles. Either one of those. So if your Cheeger constant is very small, that says with just a little bit of small damage, your network can become disconnected, and that's a bad thing if you're a telephone company. So you wanted to make sure that you designed a system which is very resilient, so you want to design something which can stand up to things.
Would you say small or large? What do you compare it to?
Well, that's a good question. So we haven't even talked about what these values can be. I claim, let's see, is this a safe claim? I claim it's at most 1. It's somewhere between 0 and 1. Now, why do I say it's at most 1? Well, if I'm counting the edges out of S, which can also be thought of as the edges out of S bar, notice that the numerator here, the number of edges between S and S bar, is less than or equal to the volume of S. And it's also less than or equal to the volume of S bar. Why do I say that? Well, the volume of S would count those edges, but the volume of S would also count edges in between that stay on the inside. So the numerator is always less than or equal to the denominator. So it's at most 1. Now, what we want to build up to is to say, well, how big can it be? What's the measurement? And we haven't yet talked about eigenvalues yet. OK. So we're going to talk about eigenvalues and relate things to Cheeger constant. So here we go. Theorem. So if G is connected, and lambda 0 equals 0 is less than lambda 1, less than or equal to lambda 2, less than or equal to dot, 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 less than or equal to lambda n minus 1, are the eigenvalues of the normalized Laplacian. And so that's the normalized Laplacian. Then we have the following. 1/2 Cheeger constant squared is less than lambda 1 is less than or equal to 2 times Cheeger constant. So in particular, lambda 1 gives you a sense of what range the Cheeger constant is, up to some appropriate scale. We're going to prove half of this. I won't tell you which half until later. I will say it is the easy half, in that half of this is really easy to prove. And half of this, it's not hard, but it's not pleasant. And considering that I only have about 10 lectures left until you guys do the really fun stuff, I should take advantage of this and just do the fun parts, the fun halves. You might look at this and say, OK, so the Cheeger constant has this nice connection to lambda 1. Now, it doesn't have a nice connection to lambda 0 because 0 is trivially an eigenvalue, which is oftentimes why they index it and say, well, really, this first eigenvalue for the normalized Poisson is always zero. So the first interesting eigenvalue is one. This is a similar thing that you see for the combinatorial Laplacian, where the first eigenvalue, that's telling you something about how connected your graph is. That's the algebraic connectivity of the graph. All right. So before we prove anything, you might ask, how good is this? Good question. In other words, could you really expect to do much better than what we have over here? So let's do two smallish examples. And one of them we've already talked about. You're probably thinking, ah, this must be the 4-cycle and the 3-cycle connected by a path. No, no, no. The cube. Let's look at the graph Qn. So let's see how much we can remember. What will lambda 1 be for Qn? Now, you've done the spectrum of Qn, but you've done it for the adjacency matrix. Now, the nice thing is that the adjacency matrix and the normalized Laplacian are nicely connected if your graph is regular. The graph is regular. That's the good news. Now, that means how do you find it? You divide everything by n. Okay, good. That's good. And then you are going to basically add one or subtract one. How would you like to think of it? But what's lambda 1? Yes! Oh, Dr. Lin for the win. Wow, that's why you have a doctorate, Dr. Lin. Someday you too can say 2 over n, and then we'll give you a PhD. But got to work up to it first. Yes, you are correct. It is 2 over n. In fact, the eigenvalues of Qn are, they are 0, 2 over n, 4 over n, 6 over n, comma dot, 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 all the way up to 2n over n, also known as 2. And then the multiplicities are what you would expect them to be. So that the spectrum is nice, and of course, what I mean by the multiplicities, this has n choose 1, here's n choose 2, and so forth and so on. It's not important here because we don't care about the other eigenvalues, we only care about lambda 1. Lambda 1 is the important one today. Okay, so there's lambda 1. Now, question here, what is h of Qn? What's the best cut to make? Now, we won't prove it, but we'll end up proving it in a few minutes, indirectly. What's a good cut to make? Yeah, well, let's talk about the one we already did. Okay, so what's the one we already did? So we have, basically what we have is we have a Qn minus 1 cube, and another Qn minus 1 cube, and we can think about then cutting the edges between these two cubes. Now, if I make this cut, we have to figure out what this is. So h of Qn, well, it's a minimum of various things. So this would be less than or equal to whatever this cut is. Now, for this particular cut, how many edges did I cut? That's right, 2 to the n minus 1, because there's 2 to the n minus 1 vertices in each half, and I'm cutting one edge between each pair of vertices. Now, what's the volume? Well, I have to take the volume of each side, but the nice thing is they're symmetrical, so you know it's the same on either one. So I'd say, well, okay, what's the volume of the lower Qn minus 1? What does that turn out to be? Now, it'll be n times 2 to the n minus 1. And why is that? Well, there's 2 to the n minus 1 vertices. Each vertex in the cube q sub n has degree n. So I'm adding n up 2 to the n minus 1 times. And aha, 2 to the n minus 1 over 2 to the n minus 1 says 1 over n. Now, the question is, how good is this? Well, lambda 1 is 2 over n, and we've just shown that 2h of g is less than or equal to 2 over n. There's not much room for wiggle there. In other words, it's tight. It's tight. And so it will follow, if this is true, and we will prove this half. Okay, spoiler, we're going to prove this. This is the part we'll prove. I'll wave my hands and say how you prove the other half. And you can, and I'll tell you where you can read it. So we will actually end up showing that this is the ideal cut. Okay. So this upper bound, lambda 1 less or equal to 2hg, there's just no way we can improve that, because there are graphs where that is tight. You'll notice that the other side has a strict inequality, where that says we can't improve, you can't get equality. So I'm not going to come up with this really awesome example, but you're not going to be far off. Let me show you what I mean. Okay. So the cube is sort of a very nice graph in terms of cutting. What's another really simple graph to cut? The path, which is a tree. Let's take the path. So, other example. So, P sub n, path on n vertices. Where should I cut?
Middle.
Yes, the middle, or as middle as you can get, okay, depending on how many vertices you have. So if you have an odd number of vertices, okay, you can't exactly cut in the middle because we're doing an edge cut. The ideal situation is if we have an even number of vertices. So let me actually draw a path with an even number of vertices. There we go. There's a path with an even number of vertices. Now, what does this say? Well, it says our Cheeger constant here, hg, the top is always 1, and so it just comes down to what can you say about the bottom? The reason I say the top is always 1, you only have to cut one edge. This is true for any tree. So as far as the bottom goes, well, you add up the sum of the degrees, you're going to get 2 most of the time, except for one vertex on the end. And so if I'd written this down ahead of time, I would have been smart and written down what this should be, but I think we can figure this out. It's roughly about, well, let's just suppose n is even for a second here. So we have n over 2 vertices here, and n over 2 minus one of them have degree 2, and one of them has degree 1. And if you multiply this out, you end up with n minus 1. And I think I've done that computation pretty close to correct. Yes? No? Maybe? Good, okay. So, roughly speaking, it's 1 over n minus 1. Okay. Now, so 1 half hg squared is 1 over 2 times n minus 1 squared. All right, that's not very surprising math. Now, do you remember what the eigenvalues of the path are for the normalized Laplace? I think we did mention this, but we may have sort of like whoosh, because it was like only one day, and we like drew a picture and like, see, it's like you do a projection, and then, it's like, whoa. What?
It was with the cycle, right?
Yes, you remembered the picture.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, I remember this whole
time. Oh, you're breaking my heart. Okay. So I'll tell you what lambda 1 is. You can go look it up later. It's 1 minus cosine pi over n minus 1. That's not really terribly surprising. And in general, it's 1 minus cosine k pi over n minus 1. K is 0, 1, up to n minus 1. Okay, so we're almost done here with the example. We still have to do the proof. Okay. Now, we're going to require you to do a little tiny bit of calc 2. 1 minus cosine x is approximately what?
X over 2.
No, that's an even.
Sorry.
So you're close, but it's not x over 2, it's
x squared over
2. All right. Well, and that's a pretty good approximation if x is small. So you can notice that pi over n minus 1 will generally be small, especially if n is large. Okay, so that says lambda 1 is approximately, doing our math here, that would be pi squared over 2 n minus 1 squared.
For large n, right?
Well, for large-ish n. Large-ish n. Okay, so what's the point here? The point here is if you compare this lambda 1 with a half times the Cheeger constant squared, you'll notice they're pretty close within a constant. So in other words, this lower bound, even though it's not tight, you really can't do much for it. You may be able to improve the constant a little bit, but other than that, you can't really improve the order. Okay, so how can we prove that lambda 1 is less than or equal to 2 h of g? Now, for that, we will go back to last time when we talked about interlacing. And we won't do all of interlacing. We're just going to focus only on lambda 1. And before it got really messy and very confusing, or at least I apologize, at least I was confused, I made a little note here. It said, well, lambda 1, you have this max and you have a min. I shouldn't say lambda 1, I did it for lambda I. But for lambda 1, we know a few things. We know lambda 0. And since you know lambda 0, and you know the eigenvector that goes with lambda 0, because we've talked about this. It's explicit what that eigenvector is. It's d to the 1/2 times the all ones vector. So what's left? Well, what we can say is lambda 1 is the smallest thing. So I'll put here an inf. It's really a min, but I'll write inf. It's achievable. Of all the vectors which are perpendicular to the vector that we know of the Rayleigh quotient. Now what we can do is we can be smart, we can replace our eigenvectors by harmonic eigenvectors. And if we do that, we get it's the inf over all, and I'll write this as f, because when you go look up later tonight the other half of the proof, the source where it comes from writes f, and I'll explain my notation. So the inf over all vectors f perpendicular to d times the all ones vector. Now, normally we've been writing f, which is a vector, as x or y, doesn't really matter. You can think of a vector as a function on the vertices. And so the author of the book, so the author is Fan Cheng, my advisor, the great Fan Cheng, my Chinese academic mother. And so she has this very much translating the ideas of manifolds and various things into graphs. And you'll see this is sort of a movement, especially on St. Yao as an example. People who are really good in manifold theory, and they're saying, well, let's take all these cool ideas and translate them into graph theory. And so one of the things that you have is you have this idea of functions on manifolds. So you say, well, okay, functions on graphs. What's a function on a graph? The answer is it's an eigenvector, or it's a vector. Okay, sorry, I'm getting sidetracked. So we're doing these eigenvectors. Now, remember that we're looking at this x transpose Lx over x transpose x. That's the Rayleigh quotient for an eigenvector x, but we've replaced x by d to the 1/2 times our f. And if you work out what this becomes, it becomes f transpose Lf over f transpose df, which means if we again translate into what this means, this is the, on the denominator, the sum over all vertices of the function f of the vertex squared dv. And in the numerator, it's the sum over all edges u adjacent to v of the function at u minus the function at v squared. Okay, so this is just a translation, f transpose lf over f transpose df into just the local sum notation. So I'm taking a minimum Rayleigh quotient, minimum being perpendicular to the vector I already know about. So this is not a very big surprise. Okay, well, what's my goal? Well, my goal here is I want to show that lambda 1 is less than or equal to 2 times this Cheeger constant. And here's a very simple observation. I just can pick a really nice vector. And if I pick a very nice vector, any vector I pick and plug into this Rayleigh quotient, that's always an upper bound. And I'm claiming that this 2 h of g is an upper bound. So I'm thinking, okay, let's find a nice vector that somehow I can connect to our cut, that when I take that vector into that Rayleigh quotient, it gives me 2 h of g. Then I have my upper bound. Life is good. The proof is done. So without much further ado, I won't pause for a very long time and say, what should we do? Okay, so let's just get right to it. Here we go. Here's the vector. So suppose S is our best cut. So in other words, I have my graph, and I split it into S complement. And so I should split at, try to separate S from the rest of the graph. That gives me my best Cheeger constant. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a function on the vertices defined in the following way. So a function at a vertex u is going to be the following. It's going to be 1 over the volume of S if I'm in S, and minus 1 over the volume of S bar if I'm in S bar. So in other words, what I'm saying is I'm taking this vector, and on one half, everything in S gets assigned one value. And on the other half, everything in S bar, that's getting assigned a different value. So I'm splitting it into two parts. OK, so let's find out what happens. So now I can say that lambda 1 is definitely less than or equal to F transpose LF over F transpose DF. So in other words, what happens when I plug this Rayleigh quotient in? Well, that's the sum u adjacent to v of f of u minus f of v. Oh, wait, hold on. I didn't prove something that I need to prove before I can make this claim. What do I have to check?
It's actually perpendicular.
I need to check that it's perpendicular to what I claim it is. So quick check. F transpose dot d1 is equal to, well, look, it's going to be the sum over all vertices in S, the degree of that vertex, U, over volume of S, minus the sum over all vertices in S bar, the degree of that vertex over the volume of S bar. Now, notice that really I'm summing all the degrees in S. If I sum all the degrees in S, what do I get? I get the volume of S. So the first term, it's the volume of S over the volume of S, also known as 1. Second term, I'll get the volume of S bar, because I'm summing all the degrees in S bar. It's hard to see that there's a bar right there, but there is a bar, I promise. It's hard to see because my handwriting is bad. But I'll get volume of S bar over S bar, which is 1. 1 minus 1, 0. Okay, good. So it's perpendicular. So yes. All right. Now, notice what happens. Well, most of the time, fu minus fv does what? In fact, there's only two things that can happen. Yes, it's either zero. Why? When would it be zero? Oh, no, not when exactly when we're not going across the cut, right? Because it's zero for the same component, because they cancel. So if we're on the same side, we cancel. If we go across the cut, what do we get? Yeah, because I'm subtracting, there's a negative. So I'm going to get upstairs edges between S and S bar times 1 over volume of S plus 1 over volume S bar. So that's what the F of U minus F of V becomes, that 1 over volume S plus 1 over volume S bar. And I get that exactly once for every edge that goes across.
Can you just square
1
over
volume? There it is. Wait for it, because something cool is about to happen. Here's something cool that's about to happen. Downstairs, what do you get? You're going to get the sum of over V of, and if you work it out, you're going to get, I can split it into two parts, V in S, and I'm going to get 1 over volume of S squared dV plus sum V in S bar, 1 over volume S bar squared dV. Now, if I copy my numerator again, so I have edges between S and S bar, 1 over volume S plus 1 over volume of S bar squared. Downstairs, well, the volume S squared, that's fixed. If I sum the degrees, what do I get? Get the volume of S. And so that the first sum simplifies to 1 over volume of S. How about the second sum? 1 over volume of S bar. Indeed, that is correct, Beth. You'll notice that this matches that. So we use some color here to indicate cancellation. So that we have the edges between S and S bar and 1 over volume of S plus 1 over volume of S bar. Now, finally, we just will say, look, what's true? Well, what's true is that I can replace and say that this is less than or equal to edges between S and S bar times 2 over the min volume S bar. Because whichever one is smaller would make the whole expression larger. But that is twice times the optimal cut, which is the shear constant. So by choosing a really good F, relating it to our cut, we can get this equality. Okay, or rather inequality. I will wave my hands next time for the other direction, because I'm way over already. And that'll do it for today, and hopefully I'll see more of you sometime today or tomorrow. And thank you. Have a good day.